there's no speed control. It's either full speed or offside.
While
a student at the University of Michigan, I got very, very close. Okay, Glenn, and I'm telling a little story for everyone to come back to. And I took physics my freshman year, but my professor often had to leave for conferences and speeches he gave and to the government. And so the substitute teacher, they had this relationship, the other physics professor. His name was Ernst Katz.
Oh, yes. Oh, we know
and
him.
Many of you probably know him. And
in the flesh.
Would have been a wonderful teacher for me, but unfortunately, I never knew that he was involved in the anthroposophy, and very intimately, but as a physicist. And he's passed away about a decade ago.
About 10 years.
And I think he would have been thrilled with the developments that have happened in the last decade of things called the fine-tuned universe and the anthropic principles. I'm not going to go into these, but I invite you to check these out on your own. But it's interesting, Nicanor Perlis recently gave a set of something like 7 lectures to a group in Australia as part of a moral technology conference.
On YouTube.
And they're posted on YouTube now,
on
right?
YouTube.
Or you can go to the Moral Technologies Facebook page and you'll find links there. In it he talks about the 6 laws of physics that give us the basis to our existence. Well, it's interesting. There are 6 Elohim that went with the sun, and we talked about Jehovah the 7th who stayed with the earth moon and then left with the moon. I find these numbers interesting. Well, the sun god, known in Persian lore as Ahura Mazda, and you can find lots of sculpture work done of him, this sun god was expected come to the earth. In the ancient mysteries, they knew about this as well. Well, I'm asking some other questions here. What does it mean for this god of the sun god, to become a human being? And what does it mean for the sun and the earth to reunite as far as the human goes? What is this earth that we live on? Is it just some speck of dust, relatively speaking, in the vastness of the universe? And Steiner says, no. Because this sun god has come to the earth, this speck of dust is the seed for the new universe. Just as in the plant, it forms the seed for the new plant. Our earth is to become that seed. And it needed the sun god. And we, as the beings of this earth, are an intimate part of what that seed becomes. We become co-creators, this 10th hierarchy. And I'm pressing the wrong button, sorry if I hit anybody. So we're going to jump now into human sexuality. And I'm going to take us through a little bit of the legends that can be found in this book from about 1904 and into 1905 called The Temple Legend. And Steiner mentions here the importance of these myths weren't to give people fairy tales that were nice stories, but to prepare those people who could not be initiated for their future lives. That these stories lived in their soul life between death and rebirth in such a way that as they were approaching incarnation, these stories lived with them to prepare them for their new incarnation. So the stories of Prometheus and so on are stories for our time. We're going to take a look quickly at the story of Adam and Eve as taught by Christian Rosenkreutz, where he talks about the 7 Elohim saying, "Let us create the human being in our likeness." And six are going to then, of those seven, leave with the sun. An unnamed Elohim creates Eve, as we call her, as an asexual human being. And then that Elohim unites, and out of that spiritual uniting, Cain comes into being through Eve. Another Elohim named Jehovah, or Yahweh, creates another human being in their likeness, but is slightly different, and is given the name Adam, which means son of the earth, or mankind is often translated. And this is also an asexual human being. This original Adam in esoteric lore is known as Adam Cadmon. I mentioned my first experience with anthroposophy was this woman waking me up at 2:30 in the morning to read me a little passage from a book called Man in the World in the Light of Anthroposophy, and she's going, "You gotta hear this. There were two Jesus children." And I never want to hear any more about this anthroposophy. Don't tell me anything more about it. Well, in one of those stories, the story from Luke traces back to Adam Cadmon, or Adam, as it says in there. So, in this story from Kristen Rosenkreutz, there are Elohim who, sorry, I'll use this word, retarded or remained behind, and those that went beyond. So the ones that were behind were able to unite wisdom and fire. And so this fire-breathing dragons is a picture from that as these beings were reaching that stage. And some were able to go beyond, in which they were able to have wisdom without personal desire. Obviously, you can feel Lucifer back here. And so Lucifer gets one of these created entities to eat from the tree of knowledge, as we all know, and then she gets the other one to eat from it. But by eating it, this tree of knowledge, she's no longer just a tool of Jehovah. It's very interesting what Simon has to say. What Jehovah desired was to make the most beautiful statues in the universe. He's trying to make human beings as beautiful as he could, but they would exist as statues. We would have this existence that we didn't really penetrate those bodies because they would be kind of statues. And it's through the activity of these other Elohim that we are not statues. So by going this route, then she no longer could be fertilized by Jehovah, by an Elohim. And by giving the apple to the other being, then she also wipes out that Jehovah's power for this being as well. So he puts enmity, he says, between thy seed and thy seed. And it's often interpreted between her and the snake. But Snyder says, it can also be read between her seed as an asexual being and this one's seed as an asexual being.
And how is the division of the sexes? Does that come before?
This is coming.
And oh, it's not here yet.
The departure of the moon.
Ah.
It's not here yet.
Okay.
So Lucifer has this incredible role to lead to human independence. And as I said, Jehovah was against this. And because they ate of the tree of knowledge, they had to have new form. They were different spiritual beings, therefore they needed different bodies. And Now they become aware that they no longer have the likeness of the Elohim. They have been changed from this experience. And so the good beings give us death and reincarnation as a gift from the divine spiritual world. But woman becomes infertile as an asexual being. She requires the physical fertilization from the man. Must come from the outside now. And so we can say that in this beginning, all beings were asexual. There were lots of them, not just two. And each child looked like the father, and the grandchild similar in that whole image. And then over time, this new way of fertilization begins to change, and we start having offspring that can look like father and mother. And so this driving out of the Garden of Eden is this sign of being pushed down into the earth, and we begin this separation. And so this is the time of the moon separating, when humanity is pushed down into the earth. And so something is withdrawn from us, that's the moon. And now the female's spiritual organs of fertilization become her organs of wisdom. And we develop a feminine wisdom and a masculine wisdom as two different things that begin because our soul bodies are a mixture of masculine and feminine. Through our soul, we will eventually bring these two together. But they are separate through early beginnings, and we will see some of where this comes. So the masculine power that the woman had in herself becomes, it's turned into the creative force, into these organs of wisdom. And the regenerative force stays with the woman, the creative physical force stays with the man. So the result of separation is the spinal cord and the brain as an image of the tree of knowledge. And so we get this duality in mankind. So fertilization after the fall, the woman becomes unable to physically fertilize herself through the spirit. She has to now be physically fertilized. And the masculine, same thing, he becomes spiritually infertile, but he becomes capable of being fertilized spiritually. Now remember, the etheric body has the opposite sex of the physical body. So as this is descending through the astrality into the etheric and then into the physical, all this separation is taking place. So in the story of Cain and Abel, we have sacrifices. Melchizedek was the high priest at the time of Abraham, and Abraham then creates a kingly lineage. But here we're seeing the comparison of Melchizedek to Abel. Abel and Melchizedek's great sacrifices, great offerings are accepted by Jehovah. But Cain's is not. Cain is already working the earth. He's tilling the ground, whereas Abel has this removedness. He only tends to the sheep. You feel that difference? Cain gives us this whole Western path of spiritualizing the mineral kingdom. And Abel says, I take what you give me, Jehovah. I'm not going to presume I'm wiser than you. I'm going to take it as you give it to me, and I'm grateful for whatever you give to me. So Abel's smoke rises up and is accepted, but Cain's smoke remains with the earth and is not accepted. So Cain slays Abel, fratricide is, and we saw this enmity that was arisen between the seeds. But here, when asked, where is your brother? He says, am I my brother's keeper? We hear